All right. Well, hey, fellas, welcome to week three of Manday Monday. Excited to be with you. I know we're offsite tonight, and yeah, we're still going to make it work. We're going to dive into week three of our series together. And whether you're watching this going into the night or you're watching this together offsite somewhere at someone's home, again, just excited to be with you and to share this with you. If you have your teaching notes, I want to invite you to take those out. And if you have a Bible, you can take that out. And we're going to get started with week three here in our series, Love Thy Neighborhood. And as you know, as we've been making our way through the series together, when we talk about this idea of loving our neighborhood, we've essentially defined our neighborhood as a group of people that are closest to us. And we talked about how that includes four different groups of people: the people that we live with, the people that we learn with, the people that we work with, and the people that we play with. And that's kind of the who as we talk about loving our neighborhood. When it comes to how, I introduced to you a brand new, for some of you, maybe something that's a little bit of review for others of you, but a strategy that we've begun to lean into together here at Pathway that we simply call Bless. And I pointed out to you in week one that God's strategy for rescuing and restoring his world has always been a strategy of blessing other people. We see this going back all the way to the very beginning with a guy by the name of Abraham, who God called out of nowhere and said, "Abraham, I have a plan for you. I'm going to bless you. And through you, the whole world will be blessed." And God has been working in that same way ever since, in the same way that he was blessed in order to be a blessing. We believe God has the same kind of strategy, the same kind of invitation for all of us as well, the same kind of rhythm of life. It's kind of like our breathing rhythm. We breathe in and we breathe out. And in the same way, we breathe in from God the things that God has for us, the things that he's blessing us with, but not just so that we can keep that to ourselves, but so we can breathe that out to others. So when God blesses us in some way, when he provides for us in some way, when he extends his love to us in some way, when he reveals his truth to us in some way, not only does God breathe that into us, we breathe that in from him, but then we also seek to breathe that out to others. And to help us do that, to help us practice this rhythm of breathing in and then breathing out and being a blessing in our world and being a part of God's mission of rescuing and restoring this world, we've landed on this strategy called Bless. And essentially, we're using the word Bless as an acronym that reminds us of and challenges us to engage in five simple missional practices that we see Jesus modeling in his life and that we believe he, in fact, invites us into to follow his lead with and to begin to practice and engage in our own lives as well. And if you remember those five practices, we had those up the first week in our notes, and just kind of reminding you of those again, we said that the five letters of the word bless represent these five different strategies or the five simple practices. The first one there, B, stands for beginning with prayer, which we talked about last week. The second one, L, there is for listening. E is for eating together. That first S is this idea of serving people and coming around the needs that they have. And then the second S there is just this idea of story. And it's a reminder for us of being able to tell God's story and to be able to share our story and learning how to share with other people how God's story has changed our story. And in fact, how God's story can relate to and influence and impact their story as well. And so again, if you're here last week, you know we began by talking about this first letter B. We talked about beginning with prayer, how it's so important for us. It's the way in which we discover our mission that God has for us. And it's also the way in which we're able to do our mission that God has for us. And so it's so important for us to begin there. I hope that you've had some chances to do that this week. And that as you've done that, as you've begun each new day, or perhaps a new relationship, or maybe a new place or space you found yourself in, as you prayed for open eyes and open hands and an open heart for those that you're coming alongside of and open doors and opportunities with them, I hope God has responded and shown up in significant ways. And so having talked about that with you, what I wanna do together with you tonight and this week is I wanna talk about the next two letters, the letter L, which again stands for this idea of listening, and the letter E, which reminds us of the importance of eating together with people. And as we get started with this, as we did last week, I wanna begin where we did by first of all, just sharing with you some examples from Jesus' life, some examples, some stories of how he did these things and essentially modeled them for us. The first one is found in Luke chapter 18, verses 35 to 42. In this story, Luke records for us some details about Jesus and his final journey into Jerusalem. On his way, actually, many people around him didn't realize this, but Jesus knew that he was on his way to the cross. It was his last trip to Jerusalem. And as he was on his way there, he approached a town called Jericho, and on his way, he encounters a blind man who's on the side of the road. And I want to read for you this kind of interaction that Jesus had with him there. So in Luke chapter 18, again, you can follow along in your Bibles or follow along with this as well. But in verse 35, it says this, as Jesus approached Jericho, there was a blind man there who was sitting by the roadside begging. And it says, when he heard the crowd going by, he realized something was happening. There was something significant going on. And so he asked, and they told him, well, Jesus of Nazareth is passing by. Recognizing the opportunity that this blind man had with Jesus passing by in the crowds there, it says that he called out, Jesus, son of David, have mercy on me. And it says there were some in the crowd, those who were leading the way that day, they actually rebuked this man. They told him, be quiet, don't bother him. And yet he shouted all the more. He shouted out again, son of David, have mercy on me. As we read on, it says this, that Jesus actually heard the man yelling out to him, and he stopped and he ordered to have that man be brought to him. And when the man came near, Jesus asked him, and he looked at him and he spoke to him and he said, what do you want me to do for you? He replied to Jesus, Lord, I want to see. And Jesus said to him, receive your sight. Your faith has healed you. This is such a fascinating story that I think illustrates so many great things about Jesus and who he was and how he worked. But one of the things that I want to point out for you here that I hope you don't miss, that I hope that you'll notice with me for a moment in this story, is the way that Jesus listened. Here he was on his way to Jerusalem. He was on his way to the cross, as we said earlier. Again, not everybody knew that, but Jesus certainly knew that. He knew what was coming. And I don't know if about you, but for me, if I try to kind of put myself in his sandals for a moment, can you imagine the weight that he was bearing? Can you imagine the burden Jesus had as he was going to Jerusalem for the last time, knowing what lied ahead? In addition to that and carrying that weight at this time of year when Jesus was traveling to Jerusalem, one of the reasons that he was going there was not only the cross, but he was actually going there to celebrate, as many Jewish people around the country were at that time, one of their most important festivals and feasts of the year, the Jewish Passover. And so Jesus wouldn't have been alone as he was traveling to Jerusalem. Thousands of others would have been there on the same road traveling with him. It would have been crowded, it would have been noisy. Depending on your persuasion, probably would have been a little bit frustrating and annoying. And again, on top of all of that, Jesus had to bear the weight of knowing where he was going, that his days were numbered. And yet, what I want to point out for you is, again, even in the midst of that, even in the midst of walking through all of that and experiencing what Jesus no doubt would have been experiencing, he took time to stop and to notice someone that many others had overlooked, and no doubt many others had chosen to outright ignore. In fact, as we just read, some of the people even tried to quiet him up or to shut him up. And yet Jesus knew the power of stopping and listening. Not only in the way that he paused for a moment to give this man his attention, but even in the way that he drew out more. He gave this man an opportunity to be heard. He not only looked to him and listened to him, but he asked for more. He said, what do you want me to do for you? He gave them the chance to be heard, and he listened to this man, and I hope you don't miss in this what an incredible act of love this was. We'll talk more in a minute about why this was so powerful. Before we get to that, though, I want to read another example for you that we find in the book of John, chapter 5, verses 1 to 9. I actually introduced this story to you last week when we were talking about some other things related to beginning with prayer, but this is the story of Jesus coming to a place in Jerusalem called the Pool of Bethesda. And as we'll read here in a moment, is a place where many disabled people and people with all sorts of issues and challenges would lay around this pool. They believed that there were some healing properties in it, that if they got into the pool at certain times throughout the year, that they could be healed. And so many of them were there, and Jesus encounters another man who was in need of healing. Let me read this for you again in John chapter 5. It says, sometime later, Jesus went up to Jerusalem for one of the Jewish festivals. It says, now there is in Jerusalem near the Sheep Gate, a pool which in Aramaic is called Bethesda, and which is surrounded by five covered colonnades. It says, here a great number of disabled people used to lie, the blind, the lame, the paralyzed. And one of the people who was there, this man who was there, had been an invalid, unable to walk for 38 years. It says, when Jesus saw him lying there, and then I love this word, I think this is a significant word here. It says, and he learned that he had been in this condition for a long time. Jesus apparently didn't know that about him, but he discovered that about him. He learned that about him, which I think can only happen as Jesus listened and asked questions and tried to discover more. And as he engaged in that way, as he chose to listen and to learn from those around him, he discovered that he had been in this condition for a long time. And he asked the man, much like he did the other man we just read about in the book of Luke, he said, well, do you want to get well? The invalid replied, sir, I have no one to help me into the pool when the water's stirred. While I'm trying to get in, someone always jumps in ahead of me and goes down before me. And then Jesus said to him, well, here's what I want you to do. I want you to get up. I want you to pick up your mat and walk. And at once, the man was cured. Again, just like the first story I shared with you, I think this is a fascinating story that, again, reflects so many incredible things about Jesus. But I want to draw your attention back to how Jesus listened. He saw this man laying there and he learned about his condition, no doubt asked questions. He discovered. He let others share and to speak. And as we talked about with the first story, he asked this man, do you want to get well? He gave him an opportunity to share and to be heard. Jesus was constantly doing this. And I don't think he did this because he had to do this. I think he did this because he chose to do this. I think he chose to do it because he knew the way that listening communicated love. And he modeled for us what it can look like for us to love through our listening as well. In addition to these two stories, one last example I want to share with you now is an example, not just of listening, but as we're talking about listening and eating, I want to share with you an example of Jesus eating and eating together with somebody else. We find it in the book of Matthew, chapter 9, verses 9 and 13, or 9 to 13. It says this here, as Jesus went on from there, he saw a man named Matthew. This book, Matthew, was written by the very character that we're reading about here. And Matthew was an interesting guy. He was a tax collector, which in Jesus' day was a totally despised and despicable group of people. The tax collectors many times were Jewish people who were working for the Roman government. And this was like working for the enemy of the Jewish people. And their role was to collect taxes that the people were supposed to pay to Rome. The Jewish people despised them for the fact that they were working for the Romans. But in addition to that, one of the other reasons people didn't like them is that many times tax collectors were liars and cheaters. One of the ways they earned money for themselves is that they would actually not only collect taxes from people, but they would tell people they owed more money than the Roman government actually wanted from them. And so whatever above and beyond the actual tax they could collect, well, they just got to put that in their pockets and keep that for themselves. And so you can imagine as they developed a reputation like that over time, people didn't really care for them. People didn't want much to do with them. Certainly people wouldn't spend their spare time with them. And yet Jesus comes and kind of flips all of that on its head. And he comes to Matthew in chapter 9. He sees this man sitting at the tax collector's booth. And not only does he spend time with him, he says, hey, come, why don't you follow me? Matthew got up like you do when Jesus tells you to follow him. And he followed Jesus. Then it says this, right after this, it says, while Jesus was having dinner at Matthew's house, so now they're going to eat together, many tax collectors, so a lot of his friends and buddies and other sinners came and ate with him and his disciples. Now when the Pharisees, these were some of the religious leaders in Jesus' day, when they saw this, they were shocked. They asked his disciples, why does your teacher eat with tax collectors and sinners? And on hearing this, Jesus said to them, well, it's not the healthy who need a doctor, with the sick. He says, go and learn what this means. I desire mercy, not sacrifice. For I have not come to call the righteous. I've come to call sinners. Again, I love this story because of all that Jesus shows to us in this, all the various things that it reveals to us about him, who he was, what he was up to, the way that he worked, the way that he did so many of the things that he did. But I also love it because it reflects one of the major themes of Jesus' life, one of the major ways that he demonstrated love to others around him. He ate with them. Food was a big deal. Meals were a big deal, not only to Jesus, but in his culture. This was one of the ways that you valued people. It's one of the ways that you spent quality time with people. It's one of the ways that you invested people by sharing time eating together with them. I love that as soon as Jesus invited Matthew to follow him, and when Matthew responded and said, all right, Jesus, I'm in. I'm gonna leave all this behind and I'm gonna come follow you. I love that Jesus didn't respond to that. And the first thing he didn't sign Matthew up for some kind of class, some Sunday school class or something to go and learn more information. And I love that he didn't just send him to some kind of church service either, that one of the first things it seemed that Jesus did with Matthew when he said, come, follow me, was to eat a meal with him and with many others of his friends who were like him. It's one of the ways that Jesus carried out his mission in the world, not only by beginning with prayer and listening, but also eating together with. And I think he invites us to follow his lead in doing the same thing. So those are some of the examples of Jesus that I wanted to share with you. And having looked at those now, I want to spend a few minutes kind of unpacking why I think Jesus did this, why this is so important, why it's such a big deal, and why he prioritized these two things in his life 2,000 years ago, but why I think it's important for us to prioritize and to step in and to engage in these simple practices in our lives today as well. And when we think about this, why we should listen to and eat together with others, one of the reasons I want to point out for you that I think this is so important for us is this, that when we do that, when we listen to people, when we eat together with people, it communicates a sense of love and value and worth to them. Now, you think about that for a moment, even without a lot of explanation, you know that this is true. When we listen to others, when we give them our attention, when we eat with other people and we share with them our time, we communicate something to them even without having to communicate anything, right? When we do this, when we look at people and we listen to people and we engage their stories, we let them share with us, or we spend time, unrushed time with people, we gather with people and we're gathered around a table and we enjoy food together with them. When we do that kind of thing, we communicate to them that they matter to us, that they have value and worth, and that they're loved. We communicate that the energy and the investment, the time, the resources, the focus that we're investing in, that it's worth it to us because they are worth it to us. Again, we see this in the stories of Jesus, and I think it's true for each of us as well. When we listen to others, when we eat together with others, it communicates to them a sense of love toward them and a sense of value and worth that we see and affirm in them. A second reason I believe Jesus practiced this and invites us into them as well is not only that it communicates love and worth, but also this. I think when we do these things, it builds trust with those people for deeper conversations. When we listen to others, it takes our experience with them to a new and different level. We're able to build rapport and we're able to build trust with them because we help them to see that we actually care about them and not just about what we might want to say to them. We demonstrate that we want a relationship and not an audience. It reinforces that we want something for them and not just something from them. And the reason why I think this is so important really in any relationship, but especially in ones in which we're seeking to bless them and ones in which we're seeking to take what we've breathed in from God and to breathe in to them is this. So later in the series, one of the S's that we're going to be talking about in this BLESS acronym is not only the idea of serving, which I think is so important, but also the idea of story and sharing God's story and our story and how our story has been changed by God's story and how their story can be changed by his story as well. And what I want to point out for you, I think many of you know this already, just kind of instinctively and intuitively, but if we just try to jump right to that in people's lives, and we just jump right in and say, you know what, we're gonna try to bless you, but we're gonna do that by telling you God's story and how God's story can change your story. If we try to just jump right to that without actually understanding their story, without demonstrating genuine curiosity in them and care for them, we're gonna end up actually treating them more like a project than treating them like a person. And when we do that, and many of you know this, you understand this because maybe someone has tried to do that with you, or maybe you've tried to do this with someone else, or maybe we're just smart enough people that we realize and recognize that. But whenever we begin to treat someone like a project instead of as an actual person, we'll never have a relationship with them because there'll never be trust. And if there's no trust, there's never gonna be any openness or transparency in any kind of deeper conversation as well. And as a result, we'll actually never discover the needs that they have or ways that we could serve or come alongside them. We'll never actually know how God's story actually translates or can influence their story. And I think that reflects then another reason why I think this is so important to Jesus and why it should be to us as well, which is this, that when we listen to others and we eat together with others, not only does it build trust and not only does it communicate love and worth, it also helps us discover where people are at and what they might need for us, ways that we might be able to serve and come alongside of them. Again, part of what we're trying to do is to meet people where they're at, just as Jesus came into our world to meet us where we're at. And if we're not beginning with prayer, as we talked about last week, if we're not listening well to other people, if we're not spending unrushed, unhurried time with them around the table, eating together with them, we may never really know the best ways to come alongside them. We may think that we do. We may think that we have an idea. We may think that we understand them or what they need for us. And in some ways, we can kind of force on them the things that we think they need without actually understanding what they really need. Again, I love the example of Jesus in asking those questions. What do you want me to do for you? Do you want to be made well? It probably was obvious to most in the crowd. They probably found themselves scratching their heads saying, what do you mean, Jesus? I mean, we can all see what's wrong here. We can all see that certainly someone like that would want help like that as well. And yet Jesus invites them to share with him. He wants to discover where they're at and what they need from him by listening and spending time together with. There's a great example of what can happen when we don't do this in the book that we're reading together as we walk through this Bless series, this Love Thy Neighborhood series together. The authors in that little book, and you'll read this over the course of the next week there, but they share a story of a missionary group that one time they were going together to go serve a remote village in India, an impoverished and suffering village in India. They had all kinds of supplies, they had all kinds of ideas, all kinds of things that they thought they could do to go and support this village. And so when they showed up, they met with some of the village leaders and they started kind of giving them this little shopping list of all the different things that they thought they could do. They said, well, we could make for you a medical clinic if that would be helpful to help take care of those needs in the community. We could build a school for you to help educate your children and prepare the next generation. We could build a church for you and help you establish a place of spiritual life and maturity and growth. We could maybe even help start a farm or something like that for you so that you have food to eat and can take care of yourselves in that way. And so they kind of went through this shopping list of options with them and they said, so which of those do you want us to do? And these people in the village, they listened to everything they had to share there, and then they responded to this, and the answer they gave was a bit surprising. Because with the people of the village, when they were given a chance to actually share, what they told them is this: those things are all nice, but what we really need is a mailbox. And you can imagine those people wondering to themselves, wait a minute, what? A mailbox? What do you mean by that? Well, the people of the village went on to explain that in India, if you live in a slum, an impoverished part of town, and you don't have, you live in one of those areas of the country, and you don't have a zip code, if you don't have a zip code, your community isn't even recognized as a real and genuine existing community. And as a result, if you're not recognized as a community, you're not eligible for the care, the resources, the programs that the government had in place to help provide for and support and take care of communities just like that. So they realized if they could just have a mailbox, then that would allow them to get a zip code. And if they could have a zip code, that would allow them to reap the benefit of so many of the resources that their government would make available to them, but that had been unavailable to them because they didn't have a mailbox. Again, this group could have gone and just done what they wanted. They could have done what they thought this village in India needed, but what was way more important was to actually spend time together with them first, to listen to them, to discover what the people actually needed. This is why it's so important, because when we do this, we discover where people are at and we discover what they need. So third reason why I think this was so important to Jesus and why he modeled it for us. The fourth reason I want to point out for you is this, that when we listen to other people and we spend time eating together with other people, it changes the relationship. There's something about it that changes. It's true with listening and eating, but I think it's especially true when it comes to eating together with other people. You know how this works. If you've experienced this before, or you've stepped into this with other people in your life, or somebody else has invited you to spend time eating together to them. I mean, we all know it's one thing to small talk with people, to small talk at work, to small talk in the driveways of your neighborhood, to small talk here at church or in the lines at the grocery store. But I think all of us, if we're honest enough to admit it and we're aware enough to recognize it, we realize that it's a totally different thing when you participate in a meal together with someone, or when you now take the next step, you meet and just sit around a table and enjoy coffee at a coffee shop with someone, or you gather for a cookout with someone, or you share in some way around the table. There's something about that that simply changes the relationship. Again, it communicates love and worth. It builds trust for deeper conversations. It as we listen well and spend time together with, we're able to discover people's stories and where they're at and what they need. And it opens the door for so much more. I know there are many people in my life who I would certainly consider to be acquaintances, people I see out and about, and we always do the small talk game with each other. We interact, we ask, you know, talk about the weather and all those kinds of things. But what I've found in my life, and I think is probably true in your life too, is that once I've spent time at a table with someone, relationships never the same. Suddenly we greet each other differently when we see each other out and about. We relate to each other differently. We connect with each other differently. We appreciate each other differently. It kind of reaches a whole new depth of relationship. It opens up a whole new capacity of things that we can experience. It's actually one of the reasons why I love having our mandate groups meet offsite in homes or at restaurants, eating together, as many of you are doing this week, because I believe that when we gather together around the table in that way, it changes the relationship. Same is true with the people that we want to bless around us in our neighborhoods, the people we live with and learn with and work with and play with. Well, that's a little bit about why I think these are so important. As we kind of move and wrap things up here over the next few minutes, what I want to share with you then now are just a few practical ideas related to how. How can we do this well? How can we begin to listen well and eat together with others well? Let me share with you a few quick thoughts as it relates to that. The first thing I want to point out for you is this, that I think we can do this well when we, first of all, commit to listen more and talk less. And I think if we're honest, we're not always very good at this, right? This is difficult because we live in a talk more kind of world. People are more concerned about what they want to say than they are usually with what other people are wanting to say. And yet James, the brother of Jesus, in the book that he wrote that we have in our Bibles, he challenged us to live differently than that. In James 1:19, he says, everyone should be quick to listen and slow to speak. I always illustrate this with people, with our kids, with other people, even just reminding myself at times by using just a little illustration from human anatomy. When you think about the way that God created us, he's given us two ears and yet just one mouth, right? And perhaps a reminder that we should seek to listen twice as much as we talk. Not only that though, I always point out to my kids when we're talking about this with them, that when they listen to us, we want them to listen with both their ears and their eyes. Because we know with our kids that if they're not looking, they're probably not listening either. And so not only do we have two ears, we have two eyes, we have four body parts for listening compared to just one for talking. I think one of the things we have to do is commit to talk less and to listen more. A second thing that I think we need to do is this. We need to avoid bad habits for listening and apply good habits for listening. We could spend a lot of time on these. I want to share with you just a few to get your wheels spinning. Perhaps you can talk a little bit more about some of these in your group. But some of the bad habits that can hurt our listening at times are some of these. One of them is this, of being distracted by other things. This is so easy in our culture. We live in a world of distractions, right? I mean, between our phones and TV and noise, constant noise and conversations and other things happening between our jobs and our to-do lists and all that we have rolling around here in our heads, it can be hard. But if we want to be good listeners, we got to avoid being distracted by other things. I think we also need to plan, or we need to avoid planning how to respond while we're listening. Again, if most of us are honest, we do a lot of that much of the time, right? Rather than listening and engaging and actually learning from people, where many times, even though it looks like we're listening, we're just thinking in our head about what we want to say. I love the quote, you find it in your reading this week, but it says this, the opposite of listening is not speaking, it's waiting to speak, right? And again, so many of us, myself as guilty as the rest of doing that, we need to avoid that. If we want to be good listeners, I think we need to avoid the bad habit of hijacking the conversation, trying to speed things up or change the direction or manipulate it in some way for our own agenda. We should avoid lousy nonverbal skills, all those things that come through in our body language and our facial expressions and all that can, again, while we may think we're listening or we may think we look like we're listening, if people read our bodies, they realize that we're not. One of the other bad habits to avoid is offering advice when they don't ask for it, which is so easy for us as men to do. Most of us are fixers, right? We're problem solvers. When we hear a problem, we wanna jump right into solving it and providing a solution in some way. And yet what we need to realize is that many times the solution isn't so much what they need to hear from us, but for us committing to just simply hear from them. And one last thing that I think can be a bad habit at times is this idea of trying to say everything instead of sometimes just something or maybe even nothing. And this can be easy to do as well. We can be listeners who then want to dump out on them everything we're thinking or everything we want to say to them in response. And sometimes we may just need to say and keep it to something or perhaps even nothing. So those are some of the bad habits. Some of the good habits of listening that I think are important for us are these, that we need to listen without an agenda, that we listen not in order to get something from them, but in order to give value and worth and expression of love to them. I think we should also listen in a non-judgmental and compassionate way, that we don't hear their story or hear about what they're going through or listen about where they're at or what they might need from us in a way in which we're constantly evaluating their story. But as we listen well, we're simply just trying to kind of join in with their story and to hear from them and to seek to understand them. Another good habit is affirming and reflecting back what you hear people say to you and responding with things, kind of repeating back and summarizing back so that they know that you've been listening to them. And then lastly, I think one other good habit I just pass along is just the idea of asking good follow-up questions to gain more understanding. I think we as Jesus followers, we ought to be the most curious people in the world. We're the ones that believe that God created everybody in his image, that every person, no matter what they look like, what they sound like, what they've been through, what they're doing in their life right now, every person matters to God and has value and worth in his eyes. And when we listen to them, we should have genuine curiosity because as we learn about them, we're learning about our God as our creator. And so I think we should always have great questions and want to learn more and understand more. We lose that as adults, our ability to be curious and ask questions. And I think one of the things we have to recapture, any of you with kids, you know how curious they are and how many bajillion questions they can ask. I think we need to capture some of that again to be good listeners, that we'd ask follow-up questions to gain more understanding. It's so important to avoid so many of the stereotypical bad habits of listening and then to apply so many of the good habits that will help us to do this well. A third thing that I think we need to do to help us with this is we need to listen to the Holy Spirit and follow his lead. This is an important one to hold on to that can be easy to forget. But part of listening to others is also listening to God, because even with the best intentions, there are times where we don't know what to say. We're not sure when we should talk or when we should be quiet or when we should say more or when we should say less. And I think because we don't always know, we should lean into the one who does always know. In Galatians 5:25, it says, since we live by the Spirit, let us keep in step with the Spirit. This is what we're trying to do, right? This is what we talked about last week. We believe God's already having a conversation with them. And so we're leaning into his knowledge and wisdom and understanding about them as we listen to them. We're listening not only to them, but listening to God's Spirit and following his lead. And then the last thing that I think can help us with this that I want to point out for you is this. Not only do we need to listen to the Holy Spirit and follow his lead, I think we need to, if we're going to do this well, if we're going to listen well, if we're going to eat together with others well, then guys, I think we've got to prioritize time with others. We've got to open up our schedules and our spaces to them. Now, admittedly, for me, and I'm guessing for many of you, this may be one of the most difficult aspects of this. Because all of us are busy, right? I mean, all of us have full plates. But here's the thing, we'll never engage in Jesus' mission in the world. We'll never engage to the extent to which we believe Jesus has actually created and called us into with him until we actually begin to prioritize. It won't happen. We won't do it. We won't drift into it. We have to plan on it and prioritize it in order to make it happen. If we want to bless others as we have been blessed, if we want to breathe out just as we have breathed in, we'll have to commit to spending time with others, to listen and eat together with. Again, in doing that, it communicates worth and love. It builds trust for deeper conversations. It helps us discover where people are at and what they need. It changes the relationship in such a powerful and profound way, but it all takes time. I just want to say this to you as a busy person like many of you, a busy person myself. There's no one in history who was more important. There was no one in history who had a more important job to do. There was no one in history with more at stake or more on the line. There was no one in history with more on his mind or on his heart or more weight on his shoulders than Jesus. And yet even Jesus, and even especially Jesus, prioritized time with others, opening up his schedule and opening up his spaces to listen to them and to eat with them. Fellas, I think we've got to find time and create time to do this as well. One of my professors in college used to say this. He said, you know what? We have all the time we need to do what God has called us to do. Drove me crazy, but he was absolutely right. Because here's the thing, if we find ourselves without enough time or our plates are too full, one of two things is the case. Either we have things on our plate, we have things in our schedule, things on our to-do list that don't actually need to be there. They're not bad things, but they may not be God's best things for us. Maybe they're things that don't actually need to be there, or they are things that need to be there and we're just not managing our time well, because whatever God calls us to, he will also provide what we need to do it. We have all the time we need to do what God has called us to do. We have to wrestle with that and do something with that. To welcome others in, to invite them into community, to spend unrushed time with them, to listen well to them. Guys, I believe this can be one of the greatest gifts that we give to people in our world. I believe it's one of the things our world is simply starving for. I believe our world wants to be heard. I believe so many people in our world just want to belong. And we can offer that to them through the simple practices of listening and eating. When it comes to prayer, last week, the commitment statement that you saw in your bookmark and in your notes was simply this, that in response to that, to begin praying, I will pray for the people in my life and the places that I'm in. And as we continue that, as we think about this idea of the L, of listening, the commitment that we want to make on that is this, that I will listen to and discover the needs of others and the places where God is at work. I hope that's you. I hope you'll make that commitment, that together we can make that commitment to that. And then lastly, as it relates to eating together, the commitment that you see there in your notes and on your bookmarks is this, that I will share meals and spend time with people in my life. Guys, this is what I want to challenge you to this week. This is what I hope you wrestle with together. And this is what I think God is calling us to do as we seek to not only breathe in from him, but breathe out to others. Not only do we need to begin with prayer, but we need to listen to others and we need to make time to eat together with others. And when we do, we can join in on God's mission and the role and responsibility that he has for us with that in the world. Here's a couple assignments I have for you in the upcoming week. I want to challenge you, as we've been doing all along, to read from our book this week, chapters 3 and 4 on listening and eating. And then just like I challenged you last week, to every morning to begin each new day in prayer, asking God to open your eyes and your hands and other people's hearts and doors to bless them and come alongside them. I want to challenge you this week to schedule at least one time with someone that maybe you don't know very well, that you can eat together or meet with for coffee or whatever it might be, but that in eating together and gathering around a table together, you can spend some time simply listening to them. I think if you do that, God will open up doors for you to be a blessing. And in doing that, you will be a blessing to someone this week. I want to give you some time now to talk about this together in your group. There's some discussion questions on the back of your teaching notes. And so I hope you have a great discussion, and we're looking forward to seeing you guys this next coming Monday.